Dear learners, welcome to the NIOS Studios. I'm Dr. Shivani Datta from University of Delhi, and I'm here to talk about growth and development. In this lesson, we would be discussing about different factors that affect growth and development. Now, when we talk about the basic factors that affect growth and development, they can be divided into two components, the factors being heredity and environment. Now, what do you understand by heredity? Heredity marks an individual's genetic endowment, whatever you have acquired through your genes. Now, human beings, they comprise of 46 chromosomes. So you get 23 from your mother's side and 23 from your father's side. These chromosomes carry the genetic material or genes. Now, if you look at this slide very carefully, the first diagram depicts the structure of a chromosome. Now, chromosome has a very interesting double helical structure. You know, it's like two spirals that have been wound together. The second image shows you a magnified version of a chromosome. If you look at the figure very carefully, you realize that the surface of the chromosome is not even. It is not smooth. It is quite crude and quite uneven. This roughness in the structure is because the genes that we've just spoken about are attached to the surface. Now, these genes are found to influence the development of child's intellectual potential, height, weight, general physical appearance, and so on. These genes actually carry chemicals or genetic material, and that gets inherited or that gets transmitted from one generation to the other. For instance, if a child has short statured parents and has inherited genes for short stature from them. Now, chances would be very high that the child too would be short statured in future because the child has inherited those genes from the mother and the father. Now, it's important to stress here that although in the example we've just discussed that if the child has inherited those genes, chances are very high that the child is going to be short statured. However, genes, they do not establish an individual's destiny, as there's another important factor that influences growth and development, and that factor is environment. And it is very important for us to understand what is the role of environment also. For instance, if I take the same example that we've just discussed, now the child has inherited those genes and the child has that predisposition to have short stature in future. However, if the environment is conducive, if the environment is stimulating, if the child is provided with proper nutrition, balanced diet, the child is engaging in stimulating activities, sports like swimming, basketball, etc., the child may be able to overcome the limits set by his or her genes. So being short statured for this child is not a surety. After this discussion, now we may be tempted to think that, all right, genes is something that you acquire, but if you take care of the environment, then you can actually undo the effects of genes. However, it's important for me to reiterate here that environment can never nullify the effects of genes. It can only moderate it. For instance, the same example, the child who has a genetic endowment for short stature might grow up to have average or maybe above average built in stature due to conducive, stimulating environment, proper nutrition that we've just discussed. But it's very unlikely that he or she will become extremely tall. Why? Because the limits have been set by the genetic endowment. The child has a predisposition or genetic endowment for a short stature. So the limits are set. Environment can have an effect and tone down or moderate the influence of these limits that has been set by genetic factor or genetic material. So the end result is always a combination of heredity and environment. Now, heredity is also referred to as nature. An environment is also referred to as nurture. So we are a product of nature and nurture, where genes and the environment are equally involved in shaping our growth and development trajectory. Now, having discussed the role of heredity, we now move forward to understand the role of environment. Now, there are different environmental factors that have a potential to impact an individual's development. The first being maternal nutrition and health. No, right at the time when we are conceived, the mother's health is of utmost importance, because we have to realize that the fetus obtains all the nutrition and all the food from the bloodstream of the mother, because the fetus is in the mother's womb. So whatever the mother is eating will eventually impact the fetus's health and well-being. So it's very important that the mother has rich, balanced diet, takes supplements, iron, calcium regularly. It's very important that hygiene and cleanliness is ensured, because if during pregnancy any infection is contracted by the expecting mother, it has a bearing on the fetus's growth and development, and not just prenatally. That means not just before birth, but after birth or postnatal impact can also be seen. Child could have permanent or long-term impairment because of the infections or because of the diseases that were contracted during pregnancy. The second important factor that needs to be kept in mind is that besides the mother's physical health, her age and emotional state also affects fetal development. We come to the factor of age first. Now, young mothers are at a very high risk of complications during pregnancy. Why is that? It happens because a young mother's reproductive organs are not strong enough to handle the stress of childbirth. So chances are very high that the young mother or a teenage mother would be experiencing a lot of complications, which could be very detrimental to the health of not just the mother, but also the growing fetus. Likewise, after the age of 35, hormonal activities gradually decrease. Now, your body secretes a lot of hormones, a lot of chemicals, which are important for regulating different processes in the body. Similarly, there are certain hormones that are dedicated to the process of reproduction. Now, after the age of 35, there's a decline in these hormones. That means the body is not secreting enough hormones or chemicals to support the pregnancy, because of which a lot of complications may occur. And women who are over the age of 40, in fact, run a risk of having children with chromosomal abnormalities. For instance, abnormalities like Down syndrome and so on. Now, with respect to emotional health of the expecting mother, emotions like rage, fear, anxiety, these are all negative emotions. These should be avoided, because the moment the mother or the expecting mother experiences stress, the body triggers the stress hormones. Like we've already discussed, that your body secretes a lot of hormones or chemicals. So you have a set of hormones dedicated to handle stress reactions. When prolonged emotional stress during pregnancy is there, then these hormones continue to remain in the bloodstream. And because of this, lasting consequences on the child could happen. Such babies are often irritable, they have disturbed sleeping pattern, they cry excessively, they are extremely anxious. So these changes in the mother's body can have long-lasting impact on the child's temperament, personality characteristics, and so on. Now we come to another factor, which is consumption of drugs or alcohol or smoking by the expecting mother. Now, drinking by the pregnant women can produce fetal alcohol syndrome. Now, what is this syndrome? The syndrome is marked by certain symptoms, including retarded prenatal and postnatal growth. That means the growth of the baby is retarded, not just before birth as a fetus, but also after birth. There is premature birth, there is low birth weight, there are chances of mental retardation, physical malformation, sleep disturbances, and in fact, researchers have shown that alcohol consumption by the expecting mother is strongly related to congenital heart disease in the baby. Similarly, smoking by a pregnant woman should be avoided, as it retards the growth of the fetus and lowers the newborn's birth weight. It in fact impacts the resistance of the baby to the illness. That is, the baby's immunity goes down. It also increases the chances of spontaneous abortion, premature birth, low birth weight, and it can have long-term physical and cognitive impairments. The next factor that needs to be considered is environmental pollution. Now, exposure to pollutants such as smoke, radiations, and something as basic as the flaking paint around the walls, which we don't even notice, can have a very detrimental effect on growing fetus. In fact, studies have shown that high levels of mercury or lead exposures, these are the chemicals which are found in, you know, paints or varnishes that we use in our homes. We don't even think about the repercussions it may have for the expecting mother. These chemicals are linked to prematurity, low birth weight, brain damage, and they can even lead to poor mental development during the initial years. Such serious is the impact of such environmental pollutants. The next factor is living condition and illnesses. Poor living condition, inadequate hygiene, lack of sanitation, lack of clean drinking water can actually make children susceptible to a variety of waterborne diseases such as cholera, diarrhea, malaria, etc. It may lead to a variety of respiratory and gastrointestinal disorders as well. All this can lead to impairment in the physical, sensory, motor, cognitive domain of the child. Another very interesting factor is the family structure and influence of siblings. Even these factors have an impact on the development of a child. Now, the family structures these days are undergoing constant change, and the number of joint families are steadily depleting. You don't find many joint families around you these days. Now, this shrinking family size, clubbed with busy schedules of parents due to their work commitments, often leave the children glued to phones, laptops, tablets, televisions, etc. Because unfortunately, they don't have many people to talk to. Now, real friends are being replaced by virtual friends, and you know, this real and virtual boundaries are practically blurred. This kind of socialization that is happening may actually have a long-term impact on children's cognition, communication skills, social skills, and so on. Children these days, they don't want to go out, they don't want to engage with people, they don't want to interact with people. They would rather prefer to sit back and play video games or watch television or play on their cell phones. This hampers socio-emotional development. This hampers language acquisition. This hampers cognition. This hampers a lot of domains. The next important factor is influence of peers. Now, beyond the confines of family, peers exert a very powerful influence on children. Now, the friend circle that kids have, they have a very profound influence on the child's behavior, interests, likes, dislikes, attitudes, everything. Children actually learn to behave in a socially acceptable manner when they start interacting with other kids. They learn the virtues of sharing, cooperation, empathy, autonomy. They acquire skills of leadership, a sense of competition, and they in fact get equipped with a lot of social skills that are required for future growth and development. And the last important environmental factor is gender and culture. Now, we live in a society, and the society always has a set of norms or prescriptions around it. You have certain gender norms, for instance, the norms meant for appropriate behavior or socially acceptable behavior. Now, these influence a child's development very profoundly, and we don't even realize that it is happening. Now, often it is seen that boys are encouraged to retaliate and fight back when they should not be coming back crying if somebody hits the boy. The boy is expected to retaliate and fight back, while crying is accepted in girls when they are attacked. So this kind of socialization right from the beginning actually is laying the foundation stone of hostile aggression in boys when they grow up. and passive and submissive behavior in girls when they grow up. And we don't even realize that we are actually sowing seeds for such dysfunctional behavior in future. Similarly, there are a lot of stereotypes. For instance, boys are not emotionally expressive, or boys are not supposed to be very emotional, or that girls, they lack assertiveness, or they are not equipped with leadership qualities because they can't assert themselves, and so on. These kind of gender stereotypes, these kind of belief systems, these kind of cultural scripts should be avoided. They should not be encouraged at any level. And as parents, as teachers, as caregivers, as elders, we need to be extra cautious about it, because these have a very long-lasting impact on a child's psyche. Now, summing up, I would like to reiterate the fact that development is a product of heredity and environment, or nature and nurture, something that we've already discussed. So it's essential for us to realize that development is a product of two factors. While we can't do much about what we inherit genetically, I mean, this is something that is given to us, but environment is definitely something that we can control. So as adults, as elders, as caregivers, we need to ensure that we provide our children with conducive and stimulating environment so that they can achieve their maximum potential. Thank you.